Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm so pleased and honored to be here to welcome our family and friends for this very special event, and that all of us who are layered in history from the early days, who knew Harvey and Norman, and of course Ronald, who has presented that family, has given so much with the thanks to you in the city, who have been so loyal and giving to the brothers and Norman, who a year ago in the Chino Theater, we did The Life of Norman and Cornelia Castro. And so it's going to be such a special treat of the program and presentation. And so we are blessed, and Ronald and Harvey and Norman are here and giving us strength and love to carry on. So may I introduce David Glick, his loyal brother, who has helped present all of this. So, David.
Abraham Lincoln said, "It's not the years in your life. What matters is the life in your years." We gather here to honor the life of my dear brother, Norman Robert Glick, who lived Shalom. Norman could recognize quite quickly where a person's talents lie and easily bring it out of them. Even though he was 13 years my senior, he always treated me as an adult. Even more so than you would think, at least according to my parents. I was always more than eager to tag along as the little runt. My other two brothers would say, "Get out of here." And he would always enlist me in some kind of project as a helper. It seemed like I was always moving him from place to place, from apartment to apartment, and it always involved a very large, heavy piece of furniture that he or Harvey or Ronald saw on the street and decided could be repurposed, shall we say. And he was forever trying to teach me life lessons. And he felt he could do so by just quoting. So it was in that earliest memory of him, I guess I was 6 or 7, and we grew up in East Flatbush. And I was riding my bike, as a little 6 or 7 year old boy would do, around the neighborhood, and I was jumped. And it was 3 or 4 boys, maybe it was more, I don't know. And they jumped me and took my bicycle. And I was crying and screaming at them. I said, "Wait till I go home and I'm gonna get my big brother. And he's gonna take care of you. Just wait here, I'll be right back." And off I ran to our house, and there in the basement, which was, to set the scene, pitch black except for there were day glow psychedelic posters all over the walls and the ceilings and mirrors, and there was only black light, and opera was blaring. It was Schwarzkopf. As my father would say, it sounded like somebody's balls were in a lemon squeezer. And I see Norman crumpled up in sheets on the bed, passed out, and a beautiful vixen, her name was Janine. She was so voluptuous, I had already written a love poem to her because I was going to take her away from Norman. And I struggled and I struggled, and I got him awake in his drug-induced stupor. He looked up at me and he said, "What is it?" I said, oh, you don't understand, these kids took my bike and they knocked me down and I need you to come with me, we gotta get the bike.
And he looked up at me and he said,
and he said,
quite clearly, it is better to conquer yourself than to win 1,000 battles, for then the victory is yours. It cannot be taken from you, not by angels, nor by demons, not by heaven, nor by hell.
And I said, no. What the hell does that mean? Are you going to come and help me or not?
Well, what he said was, you should choose your battles and fight them on your own. And he promptly turned around and went back to sleep. Soon after that, Norman went off to Vietnam, and both our lives changed forever. I cried and cried every day for weeks. I wrote him, and he wrote me back, and asking me if I was reading the books he'd left me. The Prophet by Khalil Gibran, Siddhartha by Hermann Hesse. And if I was practicing piano, he had taught me Gymnopédie No. 1 by Erik Satie. And when I say he took me everywhere with him, here are just some of the highlights. Harvey and Ron's apartment on St. Mark's Place. The Judson and the Theater of the Lost Continent to help us stage and scenery. The anti-war march in Washington, D.C. The Gay Pride Parade in Greenwich Village. And Jimi Hendrix in Central Park. Woodstock to meet the Swami Muktananda. Spent a week up there. And always, but always, Tchaikovsky's 1812 Overture in Prospect Park. So he made sure I was a well-rounded young pre-adolescent. Grand elaborate parties were the rule at the Brownstone in Park Slope, many of you will remember. And I always wonder that perhaps his most unbelievable power came from his sitting on the temple steps at Tikal in Guatemala and playing his flute. It is often said when a great man, passes on that he is measured by those in his life that he directly comes in contact with and who lives on as his legacy in both of those regards. My dear brother Norman surpassed all expectations and lived a joyous life full of the love of all people, arts, music, and dance. And what a true testament it was to his love of his life, Harvey. 52 years together, and never were there two more deeply committed and devoted lovers, ever. He would always quote famous principles to me, like, think before you speak, people in glass houses shouldn't throw stones, and perhaps his most often quoted was, judge not, lest ye be judged. It was my privilege to screen a short montage of Two by Tavel that he miraculously performed with the help of the cast last November. Alex?
Kitchenette, take two! Oh, sail on, sail on. Behind to leave the great Azores, behind the gates of Hercules. Leave him alone, Harvey. He's doing fine.
Doesn't change that much by wearing his clothes. And if his personality is similar to my personality, well, that way I can understand my own personality and so get to understand a little of his personality. Or if they are the same, I can understand his personality and so get to understand my own.
How are you, Joe? Do put your mattress down and make yourself comfortable.
Oh, I think I will. Heavens, my business is back today. Nicky, Nicky, love, how are you?
Mwah,
mwah, mwah, mwah.
How's your son, Nicky? How are you, Joe?
Oh, do set yourself down, Nicky, and I'll make you, and I mean make yourself comfortable.
She doesn't have to make herself too comfortable. She isn't staying long.
And neither am I.
Oh, could I fix you two some coffee?
Oh. I thought you'd never ask.
Can't you afford a nicer place?
Hard and hard on!
Rise in prices.
My life is just like that bitter cake. Year after year, one year piled on top of another, layer after meaningless layer.
Oh, don't cry, dear. That is the story of my life, too. One meaningless layer, year after another. Here, here, here. Have a layer!
There's just something so Elysian about everybody having his own layer.
You know, I saw him in another movie.
Only he was called by Don Maria Ospenskaya in that movie.
Well, I like to live my part.
I like to live my part too, darling. Only I can't figure out what my part in this movie is.
That's funny, because I can see from here.
They asked for it, Harvey. They asked for it, I'm telling you. They asked for it. Oh,
will someone turn on the malted milk machine?
Will you dig that? Mattress side. On the mattress. Mattress-side on a mattress!
Mattress-side on a mattress! Mattress-side on a mattress! Mattress-side on a mattress!
That this heart of mine embraces. races all day through. In that small cafe, the park across the way, the children's carousel, the chestnut trees, the wishing well. I'll be seeing you in every lovely summer's day, in everything that's light and gay. I'll always think of you that way. I'll find you in the morning sun, and when the night is new, I'll be looking at the moon, but I'll be seeing you. I'll be seeing you in every lovely summer's day, in everything that's light and gay. I'll always think of you that way. I'll find you in the morning sun, and when the night is new, I'll be looking at the moon, but I'll